Okay, Navadim, it's your sorry. It's your slot now. Sorry for interrupting you earlier. Go
Okay,
ahead.
thank you. So I share my screen. Okay, the screen is it's okay, you can see it.
Yes.
Yes, so for this training, I put all the material necessary in the shared directory, in shared sheet spectrum directory. You can see inside the go inside this directory. You can see in this directory, you can see the spectrum directory. So we go inside spectrum. Here there are two directories, the spectrum3D, it's a source code with the executables. It's the source code that I get on GitHub, and I compiled in it for the training. So you don't need to compile it, we will use this executable. And there is a directory training with the example we will run today. Inside, you have one directory called homogeneous with the setup for specfem and some Python scripts that we will use for visualization. So what I suggest now is to test if the code works for every one of you. So I suggest to you to log into a node and to copy the homogeneous directory in your workspace. I don't know if you can do, if you have some problem, let me know. So if you want, I type the command, you just need to do copy minus R slash shared cheese specfem homogeneous specfem training homogeneous dot. Is it okay for all of you? I see one yes, two yes. If you have some problem, take no.
Sorry, one question. Should we follow you exactly what you're doing, or just we just look?
Yes, I suggest to follow me in order to test if the example will work for all of you. So, I suggest to log into a node using the script get node.sh, this script, to have an alpha of node for all of you. And once you are logged, go to your workspace directory and copy this directory by typing this command. If it's okay for all of you, we can go ahead. Let's go inside homogeneous directory. And in this directory, there is a script that's called run this example. For now, I just want to see if all working well. Now just to tape run this, once you have logged in the node, just tape run this example to see if
all going well. If I run it on a copy in my home directory, I get something about disk quota exceeded.
Sorry, did you get?
So my disk.
Run this on your home directory, change into the work directory and do it there.
Yeah.
On the home directory, there's a very small quota.
Yeah, you need to go to the work, your workspace, it's a work directory.
Is we just run it. We don't like qsub.
Yes, you run the, you can see in my screen here. I just run the run this example, and you should have this appear on screen. If you, it take 1 minute to run, I think. If you have something else, that means something goes wrong.
One question, could I ask you to increase the font size of your terminal, please?
Increase the font size.
And I'm a little lost. I don't know in which terminal you are. You are in two terminals.
Yeah, okay. I have two terminals here. Yeah, one terminal with the shared directory and one terminal for the node. Increase the...
You can do just control plus and it will increase the font size.
Control plus. Is this okay?
Yes.
Okay. Is there some problem? If all of you did success to run this simple example?
It seems there's no work directory for me. Maybe I missed something because yesterday I didn't sort of fully participate.
Ah, okay. You need to run this this script, the setup.sh, before when you are logging. And it will create the all the directories.
Okay.
Okay, so if some of you have some troubles, maybe we can create breakout room and have a look more carefully what we need.
How many breakout rooms do you want, Vadim?
We are two actually. Okay. We can create two and to split maybe the. Into breakout room, the participants who want, who have problems.
So I will create two breakout rooms and only those move into the breakout rooms which have problems.
Yes.
One little question. I think I don't see the last line of your second terminal, the one below.
Ah, okay.
And I don't see what you type.
Okay.
Yeah, like this.
It's okay.
Yeah, because the microphone and the camera was overlapping this last line.
Okay. It's better now. So. So I don't see if some of you are in breakout room.
Yes, some of them have moved into the breakout rooms. Okay. But just wait a second, I'm going to put you in the other breakout room.
Yeah, okay.
We should move to the breakout room if we have problems or if we don't have problems.
If you have problems. If okay. You have problems, we will see more carefully in breakout room with
okay.
Instructors.
Okay, breakout rooms are ready.
Okay, so I will move in one breakout room and the second instructor in second breakout room, and we'll see what are the problems. And after, we will go back to the main room.
Amandine, you should have a button on your Zoom with breakout rooms, and then you can just select one.
Yes, Jose, so I can see the two rooms, room number two, and there is my name inside, but it says that I'm not in the room, and okay. I don't know how to go back.
Yeah, I will put you in room number one and then immediately in room number two, and then you can say yes on the menu that that okay. just arrived. So now you should see a window that asks you to go into room number two. Is that correct?
No, I don't see.
Do you see a menu that says more or has some dots?
More?
In the bottom, there are three dots, like just next to share screen, the right hand side.
I can see the bottom with how to divide in groups, but then I cannot do nothing.
Okay, so I'll try something else. I will take away co-host rights from you, and then I think I can, maybe then you see the menu. Let me try that.
Okay.
Do you see now breakout rooms and menu? Apparently, yes.
Okay, we are now in the main room. I don't know if the second breakout room is.
I am back in the main room, Vadim.
Yes, okay. Everyone could run the first example in your back room, in the breaking room.
Sorry, there's still some people in room one, so maybe let's wait a minute.
Yeah, okay.
Until the room really closes.
Okay.
Oh no, everybody is here now, so you can
everybody
go.
Everybody is here, okay, perfect. So, I think all of you could run the examples. I need to share my screen now. Okay, you can see my terminal with the two windows.
Yes.
Okay, this first example, actually, it was a simple homogeneous model. It's a block with 50 kilometer in latitude and longitude and 25 kilometer depth with only one material with regular mesh. It's a very simple example. We put one source at 15 kilometer depth and three stations. So, and when we run this example, we get some output directories. So I want just now you to play with some input, very simple input, with the source position, the station position. And plotting the seismogram we are computing in this simple setup. So I will show you the input file for the source and the input file for the stations. The input file for SpecFem are in data directory. You can go inside. And here you have some files that are parameter for SpecFem. The source is inside the CMT solution file, and station are inside station file. So we can see the CMT solution file. This describes completely the source. This is the name of the source, the event name, the position. Actually, this is not read by SpecFem, but it's referred to the global position of the source. In case of real earthquakes, we need to give an event name to the source. Here, I put an explosion. In this line, you have the position of the source in latitude and longitude, and the depth. And this is the moment tensor that describes the source mechanism. Here, I just put an explosion because I put exactly the same value on the diagonal of the moment tensor matrix. So the latitude and longitude in this case are in meters because we are not at a global scale. We are doing a simulation at a regional scale, and we are doing this with a Cartesian coordinate. So we need to convert the source inside the coordinate of the mesh. And the depth is in kilometer.
Excuse me, one question. Can we change, instead of using a moment tensor, impulsive sources?
Sorry?
Can we use forces instead of moment tensor?
Of course, yes. We can use forces. If you want to use forces, there is another file. So I didn't put here. Maybe we can see later. It's called force solution. And it's look like this one instead of the last line with M with the moment tensor. There is three lines for the force, for the direction. So it can be we can use either a moment tensor or a force source. So for this example, we go with a moment tensor. And we have the file stations.
One more question on the CMT solution file. So the R, T, and P would be X, Y, and Z in this case? Or?
Yes. This is a global name, but in the case of regional simulation, R, T, and P, it would be X, yes, Y, and Z, exactly.
And it's limited to one source?
No, we can put several sources in the file. We need to specify. But
okay.
If you put several sources, all the sources will be simulated at the same time.
Okay.
If you want to simulate one source after one, you need to do different file and to run SpecFem for one source and the other, and so on. So we need to launch again SpecFem.
Then it has nothing to do with the spherical coordinates then?
No. In this example, it's a SpecFem 3D Cartesian. It's in Cartesian coordinate. If you want to go, if it's at global scale, we are using spherical coordinate.
So maybe Vadim, you should explain first the mesh profile, which describes the limits of the domain. And then people can play with the position of the source inside the domain.
Okay. Yes. Maybe it's more complicated to explain that. So I just finished with the station file, and I will go to the mesh bar file. The station file is this one, called stations, and one line per stations. And you have the name of the station here, the name of the network, and the position of the station, latitude, its latitude, longitude, and the elevation or depth. You write one line per station. It's ASCII file, very easy. So with these two files, you can add stations.
Can you explain what's the NAST2 conum? One is the elevation. What's the NAST1 is?
Ah, okay. This north, sorry, the north, east, and the question is about that.
I just wonder what's the last conum is.
I didn't get your question. The north coordinate.
What's the last column?
Ah, the last. Ah, okay, sorry. This is elevation, and this is depth. You can use if you want if you are a topography, you can put an elevation of the station, or if you want, you can bury the station inside the model. You put station very deep if you want. So you can, with elevation, it will be the altitude of the station in mountain, for example. And here you can put the station deeply if you want, or just for simulation, because of course there are no station inside the Earth. Just a possibility to bury the station. Is it clear?
Yeah, thanks.
Okay. So with these two files, you can play with the acquisition setup, the source position, the station acquisition position. And of course, the source and the station have to be inside the domain, inside the domain what we are computing. And so in the domain in which we are computing is defined in another file that is inside another directory called mesh fem3d files. If you go inside, you have some other file, and those file are just parameter file for the mesher to define the geometry, to define the discretization. Basically, the first file you need to see, it's a mesh par file, which describes the geometry of the problem. You can see here, it describes the box, latitude mean, latitude max, for longitude, and for the depth. So in this case, we are considering latitude and longitude in meters, because we are in Cartesian coordinate. And the depth block is in kilometer here. So we have 50 kilometer in latitude, 50 kilometer in longitude, and 25 kilometer in depth. And your sources and your station have to be inside this domain. So maybe we can just see what was the output of the previous run. You have seen that we have put one source in 15 kilometer depth and three stations at three different coordinates. Just show you the station and 25 kilometer, 26, and 35. So, and we run the first example, and SpecFem compute seismogram for those stations and put the seismograms inside output files. All the output of SpecFem will be copy in output files. You can go in output files. Inside, you have some files, some files that was created by SpecFem. And what interesting us now, it's all the files that are at the end .semd. All those files is the seismogram that are computed by SpecFem. SEMD means spectral map method, D displacement. We saved the displacement in this case. And the name of the file, you can see here the network, the name of the station, and the component. It is it's a very simple file. It's just file with two columns. For example, get this. At the left column, you have the time. And the right column, you have the amplitude. So I propose you to try to make a plot of one of the seismogram using a Python script. The Python script is you need to go to the shared directory, shared cheese specfem. Inside your training, and you have some Python script here. And you can copy one this file, the plot seismogram.py, and put in your directory when you run specfem, I think. Okay, try to run this. I don't know if we need to load Python, maybe.
Yes, before you need to load the Python library.
Yes, we need on so mesh. Yes, so module load, Python. I see this one. We can load this and just run the process program, and it should create in output files. Okay, in output files, you will have a picture of the seismogram here, I think. So it's the vertical component for the first station. And to visualize it, I think we need to copy in your computer and visualize with a tool. I don't know if we can directly visualize in the cluster this kind of file. So that's to copy, we need to copy. You need to copy your file in your computer. Just need to find the command. So you have to copy this file. And after with a tool, I think in your computer, you will be able to visualize it. I don't know if you can see my screen when I put the seismogram.
No.
No,
you're only sharing your terminal.
Yes, I'm only sharing the terminal. So another window appears, and with the seismogram, I don't know if I can share this. now I suppose you see my the seismogram.
Yes.
Okay. Is it okay for all of you? Can you put this? Okay, if it's okay for you, I suggest that you modify the input file and play with the input file of SpecFem. For the first exercise, just a simple exercise to put more station inside the domain and plot maybe several seismogram a section of seismogram. I think the Python script already doing the seismic section. So you just, I don't know if you can edit, personally I'm using VI. Yeah, it doesn't work. Yeah. Okay. We have a trouble with VI. I don't know what kind of editor we can use. So I suggest you to put more station inside the file in order to do a seismic. A seismic line, and run SpecFem again and plot the seismogram in the seismic line. Several seismograms in the same figure with the Python script. So maybe to do that, we can go to the breaking rooms with two breaking rooms.
The rooms are open, just go into your room.
Okay.
There's still several people here. Do you have a problem joining the breakout rooms or? Let me know if you have a problem with the breakout rooms.
Okay, I think the second room is still open, no?
Yes, they are still busy. Nobody has returned from the second room yet.
Yeah, so we will wait until I think. So if during this time you can maybe change the source position or something like that to run the SpecFem. Yeah, the source position is inside this. I don't know this file. maybe if you have some question in the meantime, we can discuss.
So how do you define the source time function in your point source?
Yes, here we are using a recur source time function. The source function is inside Spectrum actually, and the characteristic of the recur is given by the time shift here, and here it's called the half duration, but it's not true for the recur. For the recur is the frequency, the dominant frequency. I put dominant frequency 0.8 hertz.
Okay, so it's always there's not possibility to have a different one.
There are possibility to have a user defined source time function. In this case, you need to provide a file with the time and with two columns. The first column is the time, and the second column is the amplitude of the source. And there is a flag in other parameter file for input for Spectrum that you need to turn on in order to read this user file. So there is a possibility to read any source time function. In the training, we choose to use a predefined source time function to be easy.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Yes, I want to wait for the participant to show you the par file, because it was just the file about the source station. After to the input flags for Spectrum are in other file, you can use a lot of options by turning some flag to on, off, and the possibility to use external sources or force sources. The different kind of sources are inside this file actually.
People are coming back from the second room, so I close that. And then okay. Second, everybody should be here.
Okay, perfect. So I think everyone should succeed to run and plot the SysProgram section. Now, maybe we...
Wait a second. Amandine is not here yet, and there's a couple of people still missing.
Okay.
Could you please again increase the size of the font, please?
This one?
The third one.
Ah, okay. Sorry. Yes, but this is on my computer. It's just copied file from cluster to my computer in order to visualize it inside in my. But maybe it's not so important.
Everybody is back now.
Okay. I guess everybody succeed to run this simple example. Now, maybe we will go in more detail in the parameter files for Spectrum. We will see in more detail how to mesh, how to define a model and a mesh with internal mesher. Actually, I just want to show you. When we relaunch this, there were several things that was launched actually. The script automatically copy the executable that I compiled in the shared directory here, inspect them. Create some directories for output and copy here the executable in the local directory. Copy input file that we are using for remember. And it launch three codes actually. The first code is a mesher. We run xmeshfem3d that defines the geometry, the domain, and the material properties. The second code is here. It's called xgenerateDatabases. And this, it's input mesh, input data for specfem. In this, the input file are created from the mesh we obtained previously, and put the material properties for each point inside the mesh, and also define the discretization inside each element, the polynomial order that we want to use. We have seen that in the introduction specfem that we can use different polynomial order to interpolate function inside each element. And we choose here which order we want to use. Actually, here we are using the polynomial order of 4. That means we need to have five point discretization inside each element. After that, we have all the input file for specfem, and we can launch the specfem code. So when you launch this script, you're actually doing three things. You mesh, you prepare the input file for specfem in the right format after the mesh, and then you launch specfem. So now we will see how to use this code, xmeshfem3d. So xmeshfem3d is internal measure for specfem. It's very simple measure. If you want to mesh some layered model or very simple model with topography or some inclusion, you can use this internal measure. It will be more suitable sometimes. So to launch this code, xmeshfem3d, we need some input files. The input files are inside the directory data. And inside the directory data, you have another directory that is called meshfem3d files. And here you have three files. The most important file is mesh tar file. We had already a look on this. We define the block we want to mesh with latitude, longitude in meter, the depth block in kilometer. We don't use these two options. We don't use UTM projection. So we directly use Cartesian coordinate that we write here. Here we have an interface option. We can mesh some interfaces inside the domain. And to mesh it, we need to put the interface file in this file, actually. We will not use this cavity file, this example. Here we define the number of elements in each direction. So here we choose to use 32 elements in latitude direction and 32 elements in longitude direction. And here there are some problems on my screen. because it should not be like this. I just clicked VI to switch into a more and here we define the number of process MPI processor that we want to use. It's in order to cut the mesh and to distribute each slice of mesh from two different processors. And we are cutting in direction latitude, in direction longitude. So here I choose to cut the mesh in four pieces in latitude direction and in two pieces in longitude direction. At the end, we have eight MPI slices. If we go here, there's an option to use regular mesh or irregular mesh. We can define some special element that allow us to go from one size of element and to double the size of element for a given layer. It's suitable for layered model, which the velocity increases with depth. So in the first example, we don't use an irregular mesh. We are using a purely regular mesh. And here we have some option to have some visualization file. Yeah, we turn it to false, all of them. And we have an option for PML. We don't use here, but we can use PML for absorbing layer condition. So we'll not use in this training. And this part is devoted to the domain materials. So here we define the material properties that we want to use in the mesh. We need to give the number of materials. Here we have one material in the domain. And here we define the properties. This is a material ID, the first material. The mass density, the P wave velocity, the S waves. This is attenuation, Q kappa, Q mu, and anisotropy. And this flag is because we are inelastic here. So in this case, we are using only elastic isotropic material defined by three parameters. When we put Q factor at very high value, that means we don't use the Q factor, we don't use attenuation in this case. And in the end, we need to define the region of the mesh and assign each region of the mesh with a material properties. In this simple example, we define only one region with one material, this one. So to assign this, we just need to give the coordinate of the node. We are going to, for the first node to the 32 node in X direction, first node to 30 node in Y direction, and the first to the 16 node in Z direction. And this is should be consistent with the number of nodes we have defined in each direction. So maybe now I propose you to do a run. I suggest you to add a new material inside this mesh, inside this mesh, yes, and put an cubic inclusion inside the mesh. To do that, you need to go at the end of the file and to define another material, not only one material, but two materials, and add one line here with another material properties with a flag 2, and add a new region will be two regions. They add the coordinate of the two regions. Here we have a mesh with 32 elements by 32 by 16 elements. So the goal is to define inside this mesh an inclusion with different material properties. And you need to put the coordinate of the nodes that you want to change the properties in this slab. Is it okay for you?
Maybe just one question associated with this.
Yes.
So I assume that basically it sort of overwrites what's below that. So, you know, if I want to make whatever, a little cube in there, I just give those coordinates and it replaces what was before there with those new values. And if I would put like three or four bodies in there, if wherever they overlap, it's the last one that counts, or how does that work?
Yes, I think it's the last. It will read the first material. It will assign the wall here, the wall domain for this material. After, it will read the second line and replace the previous material by the new material in nodes that you are putting in file. It's the last, yes, the last is will be taken into account at the end. So it's mandatory to have for all nodes at least one material assigned. And after, if you add some lines, it will be changed. It will change the material properties according to your node number you put here. I think maybe we can go to the breakout room to do that.
Tim, you can say that the first Z element is the bottom one, and then element number 16 is the top one.
Okay, you're right, yes. We'll begin by bottom. In Z coordinate, yes, right. Okay, well, let's go to the breakout room. Okay, we wait some minutes until the second room will finish. Is the repository here? No, not yet. can you try to, I put a new script here in the shared directory, in cheese specfem training directory, I put visumodel.sh. Can you try to copy it on your work directory to see if you have the permission to do that? And if it's okay.
Copy it, in the homogeneous directory as before, or does it not matter?
Sorry, I don't hear you.
Shall we copy it in the homogeneous directory from before, or?
Yes, inside, copy the script inside the directory where you rerun the specfem. Just this script. You can see my screen, this visumodel.sh. It's to be test if you have the right to copy this. Is it okay?
Yeah, it seemed to work.
The permissions are correct.
Okay. So this script is to visualize the mesh with ParaView. It's a script that changed the format from specfem to ParaView format, and it's to visualize the mesh. So,
but even the second room is not ready yet. Yes, they're not here.
Okay. Okay, maybe I can go to the this breakout room to see. I don't know if I can go to the second breakout room.
You have this breakout room menu, and there you should be able to move into breakout room one, and then from there you have to move into two.
Okay.
But wait a moment, maybe I can assign you to the other one.
Yeah, let me see.
Yes, if you enter breakout room now, you should be in number two.
Okay, perfect. I'm going to back on room two.
Everybody is back, you can continue.
Okay, perfect. I am sharing this screen. Okay. So now we will see how to visualize the model, the mesh with the model we created. So to do that, I put a script in Cheese Spectrum Training. Here, the script, the name of the script is visumodel.sh. You need to copy this script in your directory when you run SpecFem. So it's here for me. And to visualize the model, we just need to call this script with the name of the parameter that we want to visualize. We are allowed to visualize density, VP, or VS. For instance, we choose the VP model. And just, I am not in Node. Just need to run this script, but before just to load the right modules. Okay. So since I compiled the code with the Intel compiler before running something, we need to load the Intel compiler. And to do that, we have two commands. Module load compiler Intel 19.1.0, first one, and second one is Intel MPI. So if you have some trouble to run the script, you need to load this this compiler. So did you succeed to run the script like this with calling the script and the name of the parameter you want to visualize here, VP?
Can you repeat which module we have to load?
Yes. The first module, it's compiler, Intel compiler. This one, you need to type module load compiler Intel 19.1.0. And the second one is this one.
Maybe we can copy to the chat so that we can just copy it.
Yes. Okay. This one.
And under which directory should we run this script?
You should run the script in a directory where the specfem run, that in the homogeneous directory. Exactly. When you launch specfem, you run the script at the same directory. So if the script run successfully, you should have a VTK file that's called vp.vtk inside output files directory to visualize that. We need to use ParView. I don't know if you already use ParView for previous training.
Yes, we did.
Okay. Yes, in the chat there are a warning, but I think it's working despite this warning. So there are no problem from.
Excuse me. Once again, once you finish the job with the script, we get where?
We get inside, we have here inside the output file directory. Here, you have a new file that was created that's called vp.vtk. Is it okay for all of you?
Yeah.
Okay, so for visualize that, we need to copy in our computer. So I'll copy that in this file in my computer. Okay, is it okay for you for copying? But it's not a big file, but it's about 3 megabytes. So after that, you just need to run ParView and open with ParView this file. So I will try to share the ParView. You can see ParView code by you only in the screen. Okay, just we need just to open the VP file. You open, you click apply, and you have the mesh we have defined. If you put mesh with edges, you can see this is the shape of mesh. The model, this VP model, it's a homogeneous block with 5.8 kilometers per second amplitude velocity. And inside, we put an inclusion with different material properties here. So you can do a visualization of the model in an easy way here. Is it okay for all of you? Okay, it seems working for there are no trouble. No.
One question. Changed my mesh and I put the little box inside, but in my ParaView screen, I don't see the little box inside. I don't know why. Did you change something?
No. I didn't. Did you run again the example by using the script from this example?
Using some sparse FFTs.
Yes. Maybe I did something wrong. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I can show you again how to do a slice with ParaView. When you load the model, you need to click.
Yeah, exactly. That was here. What I was missing, the slice. I don't know how to make it.
Yes, you click here. I don't know if the toolbar is exactly the same. It depends on ParaView version, actually. But here you have a kind of a clip, here a slice. You have several options to select, to change the visualization. And if you click on clip, you click first. After me, you need to click on apply, and the model will be cut. And after, you can play with the slice plane. There are some troubles, so is it okay? you have also another option to that allow to see you the elements. Okay, so it seems that everybody succeeds to visualize the model. So we can go back to the cluster. Okay, so now we have computed the data, some synthetics inside this model with heterogeneity inside an inclusion in homogeneous model. So what we can do now is to compute a sensitivity kernel for this model. The sensitivity kernel, it's a kind of gradient of cost function. We will suppose that the real model is this one. And we start with initial guess model without inclusion. And we will compute for VP and VS waves sensitivity kernel using SPECFEL. So to do that, we need to prepare another directory. We need to keep this one like this, and to make a new directory. So I just show you how to do. We just need to make a new directory and get here. So we have to name it sensitivity kernel. We need to go inside this new directory you created. You see I have created the directory just near homogeneous example that we just run now. We keep this example here, and we create a new directory. So is it okay for you, this creation of new directory? We're going inside this directory, and we will copy some input from specfem inside this directory. So we just copy some input from the homogeneous directory when we ran previously. We will copy the data directory. And the script to run the example. And here we will we will start our initial model that is homogeneous model. So we need to remove the modification we done previously inside the mesh part file.
Sorry, could you please again increase the font size?
Yes.
Control plus, please.
Is it okay now?
A little more, please.
A little more. The problem when I am increasing the font size, I have a problem with VI editor. This is I cannot edit correctly. Sometimes I don't know why. Yes. No problem here. So basically, you just need to remove the segment material, the inclusion of your mesh. You need to go back to the first example, actually. You need to remove this line to put only one material and to put only one region and to remove this line. Then it's inclusion. It's just to go back to the like the previous model, only homogeneous, and once you have that, we'll be able to run specfem with different option in order to compute a sensitivity kernel. So I will try, but I don't know why. I have some problem with VI. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Top terminal. Yes. I don't know if it would work in this. Maybe it's better. Yes. So I just need to remove this line. This one. Put only one material. Is it okay for you? Remove that.
Yes.
Okay. So now we will change some parameter in input file for specfem. So is the main input file for specfem, the main where all the main input where there are all parameter or flag to turn in off in specfem is situated in data bar file. This is the main control file for specfem. And actually there are a lot of flags. You can go through the specfem file. This bar file, there are a lot of flags you can see. We will not have the time to go in detail for all flags, but in the manual of specfem, you have an explanation of all the flag you can use. So now we will just go to the beginning of this file. Is it okay for you? Did you find this bar file? Okay, so to make a sensitivity kernel, we need to do an adjoint simulation. We need to do first a forward simulation in order to compute synthetics inside the initial guess model. We'll compare the synthetics with data. Data we will consider here is the synthetics that we are computed in a model with inclusion. The initial guess model is just a homogeneous model. And we need to run forward an adjoint simulation and to make the sensitivity kernel step by step by using this both simulations simultaneously. So the first step is to prepare the synthetics. So we need to prepare the synthetics by doing a forward simulation here. So we put simulation type at one. And in order to prepare the adjoint simulation, we need to save the forward wave field. So we need to here to turn this flag to true. Is it, it's okay? Just save the path file and run again the example. Okay, the run is finished in my side. So now we have synthetics, computed in homogeneous model in output files. And this is synthetic seismogram here. And we need to compare the synthetics with data. And we consider the data is the synthetics that we have computed before in inclusion, in the model with inclusion. So we need to do the comparison, to do the sample difference between the synthetics and the data in order to define the new sources that called adjoint sources. And we need to put these adjoint sources in the directory, a special directory. And we need to create this directory in order to put the sources. So this directory is called SEM. S-E-M, we need to create this directory when spectrum run. And after, you need to use a Python script that allows us to create adjoint sources. So the Python script is in shared, which is section training in Python script. And there are directory called write adjoint source. We need to copy this file. Okay, you need to do some modification for the path inside. This Python script in order to be able to define the adjoint source that compares the data computed in inclusion model against the synthetics computed in homogeneous model just now. So. I am copying this script in my running directory. Going to the directory here. So in this Python script, you have some paths to fill. This is actually called forward simulation, the forward simulation that we just done. So we need to put the name of the current directory here. Is it working this? Okay, so sensitivity kernel here. and here it should, the name is homogeneous. So it's, actually, it was with cube inclusion, but the name, we keep the same name. And the station, in, yes, we will compute the sensitivity kernel for one station in order to see Banadonna kernel. So I think it's okay. I just okay. Okay, you just run the Python script. So there are some here is the pass.
The pass written like this, I don't think it it's working, so you should put dot dot dash sensitivity kernel.
Sorry, I
should. I think that the pass like this, like homework, it's not working. Maybe write the full pass.
This full pass. Okay, now it's wrong. Is it okay for all of you? You should have in the same directory. No, I think. While working with open source.
Excuse me, one question.
Yes.
The path to input model should be pointing to the homogeneous or to the cube?
So the for the forward simulation, this is for the input model should be pointed to the sensitivity kernel, the current directory where we want to compute the sensitivity kernel.
Mm-hmm. And the other one,
the other one,
current model?
It's homogeneous because if we in this directory, the last run we did, it's for cubic inclusion. So we get synthetics computed inside the cubic inclusion model. This will consider as data. And here in sensitivity kernel directory, we have an initial guess that it's homogeneous model. And you want to compute the sensitivity kernel for the cubic inclusion. Is it okay or the name I am maybe confusing because we did the same work inside the homogeneous directory.
So basically you should be in the in the folder you call sensitivity kernel. So you define the path to input model as this folder. And the path to the current model should be the cube inclusion folder. So in the cube inclusion folder, you will read the data And in this folder, sensitivity kernel, you will read synthetics data that we just computed for an homogeneous model.
Yes, that's correct.
It's just that in the case of Vadim, he didn't call his folder cube inclusion.
Yes,
he did everything in the same folder homogeneous. So that's confusing for you.
Yes, maybe. Yes, if some of you change the name when they run the cubic inclusion, they should point in this directory. I didn't change the name. I did all the runs inside the same directory, actually.
And once we run this great Python code, I don't see the output.
Yes, I didn't see the output. I don't know where you put the output. I have to find out. It should be same past the current model. He has created the output in this directory, right? Homogeneous. So just copy the output from homogeneous cell. And output, yes, it put the output actually in the past to current model, in the previous directory. Just copy. Is it clear for you? It's a little confusing.
Yes, so there are three files.
Yes, there are three files for the station. We choose one station. And for this station, we define three components for the hydrogen source. The Y, X, Y, Z component. Actually, this is the hydrogen source. And now we are ready to run the hydrogen simulation. If you have this directory SEM with these three files, you are ready to run the hydrogen simulation. And to do that, we need to change some flag inside the PAR file. We need to edit the PAR file. Now we change the simulation type. Previously, we ran only forward. Now we will run adjoint and also forward in order to compute the sensitivity kernel. So the flag we need to put here is three. We are running both simultaneously, the forward and adjoint simulation. Here we need to put this to false. We don't need to save anymore the forward simulation because we already did when we did the first forward simulation. And I think that's it. So we need now just rerun the run this example. Don't run this example, sorry. Because it will kill some important result if we do that. So we need to copy this script in another script. We will call it run specfem. We want to avoid to run the three steps that we run previously, the mesh, the database generation, and after specfem. We want just to run specfem now. We need to keep exactly the same mesh. And the result that specfem run previously. So previously, we wanted to save the forward run. If we run the full script, we'll remove this result. So we just need to copy that and just to remove some of code. Some of call of code. So can you see correctly the we need to avoid to make again this directory, to clean the directory. The executables are already copied. So we need to avoid that. What's that this? We can keep this. We need to remove that. And remove the calling to the Mesha. This also. This is generic databases we don't need anymore. So at the end, we just in this script, we just want to call the xspecfem code, just specfem code, just the simulation.
So all the rest can be deleted?
Yes. Yes, you need to delete. Maybe I can put this. I will try. I just.
Maybe you can put this script in the shared directory.
Yeah, I will put that. I just forgot about this session adjoint. Actually, for the adjoint simulation, we need also to define a session file for the adjoint simulation. So for that, simply we copy this file and name adjoint. Is it okay for you? You go to the data directory. In data, you have the session file. We will define some station to compute the adjoint wave field. Actually, we will use only one station. So we need to put only one station in this station adjoint file. So I suggest you to copy the whole station in a station adjoint and after to remove the station that we don't need. So remove all the station except this one. This the session you choose to run the adjoint simulation. So after that, I just need to check that. So I just need to. Delete also that. I think it's okay. I will try to run. If it is correct, I will copy this script in shared directory and you will run it down. So just last check. Now it will take more time because we are running two run at the same time, the adjoint and the forward problem again. And this takes twice the time from previously. So I think it's quite. Can you try to copy this script run specfem.pds from shared cheese specfem training? Okay, my side drawing is finished. Do you want I repeat again how to launch the adjoint simulation, or it's okay for you?
I think you should repeat.
I should repeat. Okay. So to launch an adjoint simulation, we need first to, let's begin with the station. We need to define the station adjoint, the file station adjoint, this one. It's the station will be taking into account for the adjoint simulation. So here we have chosen just one station to do a very simple case. I picked one of the station from the station file that we have computed the synthetics. And after that, we need to modify the par file. In par file, we need to change the first flag that is called simulation type. We need to switch to number 3 because we want to do a forward in the adjoint simulation simultaneously in order to compute the sensitivity kernel. And we need to switch save a forward to false. We need these two things. We have also computed adjoint sources here. And once these three things are done, we just need to run this script that I just copied in the shared cheese spectrum training directory. And once you run that.
Sorry, I don't know if it's a problem from the script, but my simulation end with an error.
Okay, maybe we can go to the breakout room to see more precisely what happens. No. José is here.
Adin, do you want the breakout rooms now?
Yes, please.
Carlos, can you hear me? Carlos Lozano, can you hear me? Room two, okay, in a moment.
Okay, I think the second room is not here. So if the code runs successfully, you should have in database directory some files that are called kernel.bin.
But in the other group is still missing, should I call them?
Yes, please, maybe we should call them if they can join us.
Okay.
Yes, I have the kernel.bin files.
Okay, that means the simulation, the forward and joint simulation run. And
everybody is back in the room.
Everybody's here. Okay, so if the adjoint simulation and the forward simulation run successfully, you should have in the database underscore MPI directory some files with the name that ending by underscore kernel dot bin. Is it the case for all of you?
Yes.
Yes. So now we will do a visualization with ParaView of a kernel we just computed. We need to use the visumodel.sh script. We just need to copy the script inside the current directory where you run the adjoint simulation. And I suggest you to do some modification, one small modification inside the script. I'll go here. Just to edit at some line, you have here. Here, there is we choose the resolution and the output file. We want to see the kernel with high resolution. So the output file will be bigger. I don't know if you will be able to download it, but let's try. Just you in the visumodel.sh, you just need to change the resolution of the output by just changing a flag at line 28 of the file to switch from 0 to 1. And just save it. And it's working exactly like for the VT model. Just need to call visu model.sh and the name of the kernel that you want to visualize. In this case, alpha, it's correspond to the VP kernel. So just and at the end, you should have in output files this VTK or paraview file. And this is big. I am able to download it, but I don't know if depending on your network. Didn't get such files. It's not homogeneous. Sensitivity. So, did you create this file?
Yes.
Okay. I don't know if you can download it to Visualize because it's big, but if you can try to do this. And after we will visualize this file with ParaView. So I'm mentioning ParaView. Just need to change. My screen. Okay, exactly the same. You need to read. The file. Alpha kernel dot btk. Click on apply. After you can take a slice by clicking this icon, slice in the middle or down of the kernel. We'll take a second slice. And by clicking here, you can see the kernel. So you have a lot, a very, very high value of kernel just close to the source and the receiver. And you can see here the value of the sensitivity for the VP, sensitivity VP, inside the model. You can play with the color scale. Okay, yes, I have a bad version of ParaView here. It's too old. Do nice snapshot. I will do it. And just okay, I just open a new parallel version and I will share the end of the screen. So I am loading again the alpha-kernel.btk. Taking a slice in y direction, slice in z direction. Okay, with this hash it values better. So this is a sensitivity kernel for one point source, one receiver, and an inclusion between the two. It looks like a banana donut kernel. We are in its transmission regime. And this is the basic tool to do seismic tomography. For seismic tomography, we are using several sources, several receivers, and we compute several kernels. And by summing all the kernels for all sources, all receivers, we have a way to do a perturbation of the model in order to fit better the data. So basically, with this tool, we can perform seismic tomography by to put this tool inside a workflow that manage the data, manage the synthetics, and manage the all the sensitivity kernel for each source and receiver to make a global gradient field to update the model. And this is a basic step, and we need to do several steps, several iterations in order to converge, to reduce the misfit of the cost function, the misfit between data and synthetics, and while the misfits reduce, the image and the model should be closer than the true model. Okay, I think, I don't know, do you have some questions? Did you succeed to visualize that, or the file is too big, or something goes wrong?
Yes, it was okay.
Okay.
So I have a question related to what you were just sort of explaining about inversion.
Yes.
So, because the way you showed us to specify the model, yes, you specified in terms of whatever, a handful of properties and then some regions where you have, you know, this velocity, and in a different region you have another velocity. But of course, after I've done, let's say, the first step, yes, I've calculated my adjoint, I've calculated my sensitivity kernel, I have updated my model, I basically have a velocity that's different more or less everywhere, yes, in each cell. So is there an alternative way to then get this back into SpecFem and, you know, do the next iteration, calculate the next forward model, or what's the strategy there?
Yeah, in SpecFem, after you need to have some additional tools to post-process all the these things. You have some Python tools like SaceFlow, these Python tools
yeah.
will read all the output of SpecFed, all the kernels. It will do the gradient, the global gradient by so do a addition of different kernels, do a model perturbation, and change in this model perturbation will be in the right format for the next iteration. Actually, in GitHub, you can find this tool. It's a Python tool that called SaceFlow.
Okay.
And it's interfaced already with SpecFed. There are some examples. And you basically doing this in automatic way. Because here I wanted to show you how exactly it works with SpecFed, but you can put all those steps in a bigger workflow, like with Python Pro, for example, and you can do some do something by automatic way.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll have a look at that because I'm sort of probably interested in something slightly less automatic than size flows, but there I can see, of course, if you say they've already done it, sort of what the steps are that are required.
Yes, all the steps required are done in size flow.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, maybe there are another question, but because I think now we are close to finish, I guess. So we cannot do another example. So, okay, so I will go back to the cluster. Yes, okay, we didn't have the time to have the time to see how to put a topography inside for the model and interfaces, but it's just in Mesha you this file which define the topography, for instance, instead of meshing a block, a flat block. We can mesh, we can add the topography at the top of the block, and we need to define a topography file in this additional file. So we didn't have the time to do that, but just to keep in mind that we can mesh some more complex model that we did until now. And I think you can find all the some examples with topography and more complex example in GitHub, in SpecFed directory in GitHub. Maybe I can show you in this screen. Actually, this I downloaded this version of SpecFed from the GitHub, and in the SpecFed package, you have some examples here, and you have very simple examples like layered alt space, homogeneous acoustic, homogeneous elastic, and you have more complex examples with coffee mug mesh, with a volcano mesh. So you can go through to this example to see how does it work. actually the input file are exactly the same that we have seen. Here the CMT solution, the par file, the station file. Here you can use a topography from this Mount St. Helens. And you have in every example, you have a README that explain step by step how to run this example. I think there are a lot of examples you can go through, and I think you will find some basic basis, and after you can modify a little bit this example to fit your needs, I think. Yeah, example our tomographic model here. You can refer to that. You see how does it work. So I think if I'm not wrong, it's the end of the session. I don't, Jose, can you confirm that?
Yes, we are at the end, yes.
Okay.
Perfectly in time.
So thank you for your attention. And I think tomorrow we have another session.
Okay, thank you very much. And we will all see each other or hear each other tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Have a nice afternoon, evening. See you tomorrow. Bye.
See you tomorrow.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.